Good afternoon. Were I to write a textbook of this country, its title would undoubtedly be America, a Study in Racism. Our history is overloaded with just, let's say, one culture trying to impose its ways upon another, whether it be that of the black, the Chicano, the American Indian. We have with us today Mr. Vernon Bellecourt, director of the American Indian Movement, who will talk about the Wounded Knee incident right now and what the American government is doing.
This is what they call civilization. I just drove from Pasadena. It's unreal. First of all, I'd like to say that and kind of give you an immediate appraisal of the situation at Wounded Knee, and to kind of take care of some of these announcements. At the present time, the agreement was that the United States government was going to pull back its federal troops. This was done, and it was heralded immediately. We recognized that these orders came from higher up in Washington and perhaps even to the White House, and they pulled out. And yet, even as they pulled out, they attempted to infiltrate the Wounded Knee perimeter by bringing in four federal marshals, FBI agents, trying to pose as postal inspectors. And I guess they thought we are still that naive savage, you know, that roamed these plains all these years. But we ripped them off immediately. Our security got on, and we ripped them off and took their guns and marched them out of camp. You've probably perhaps seen that. It's kind of a switch today compared to what this government's been doing to people all these years. Additionally, they pull and put back a cordon, and they've completely blockaded Wounded Knee at this point. Luckily, during the time that they were pulled away, we were able to get in two truckloads of supplies. But we understand that they're running short, and what they are trying to do, as they tried to do 83 years ago at Wounded Knee and other massacres against Indian people, and not only Indian people of this land, but sovereign people throughout this world, they've attempted to freeze them out or starve them out. We all know the criminal acts of war that took place in Vietnam and destroying the rice paddies, etc. So you can see that the government hasn't progressed too far in the fact that they are now once again trying to freeze us out and starve us out at Wounded Knee. But what is happening is that from Oklahoma, from Canada, from several other states, large groups of concerned people, not only Indian people, but we are forming strong coalitions at this time with the black movement, with the Chicano movement, with all third world people. And at Wounded Knee, right at this time, arm to arm, and standing side by side, we have black brothers, we have white brothers, members of the various peace movements, Vietnam veterans against the war. We have Oriental brothers, we have Chicanos. We have third world people are standing with Indian people today and are forming one of the strongest coalitions that this country will ever see, and we will continue to unite together to deal with the common enemy. This is what's happening at Wounded Knee right now, and our people are prepared. They're digging in. Indian people, we like life. We don't want to die. But as Crazy Horse said in the past, that it's a good day to die. What the American Indian Movement is saying right now, it's a hell of a good day to fight. And that's what we're doing at Wounded Knee. Now, I'm going to put a special request here of you. We are going to ask that today, from 3 to 6 o'clock and beyond. Now, there's talk that we might continue this around-the-clock demonstration, picking up momentum, to show that we have solidarity, to show that concerned American people are no longer going to tolerate massacres in this country or any place else in the world. We are going to ask that all of you call your friends, call other organizations, and join us. I believe it's at 300 Los Angeles Street or Los Angeles Avenue. It's the federal building. We are going to start rallying there about 3 o'clock, and we will perhaps go right around the clock until the crucial situation at Wounded Knee is eased. I'm going to also ask all of you today to make contact with your various congressmen and senators, to make contact with the various heads of churches that you may be affiliated with, because these people have influence. We are going to ask you to all stand with Indian people at Wounded Knee. Either stand with us morally, spiritually, physically. If you can't do any of those, what we need is dollars to continue to buy supplies and to move supplies into Wounded Knee. because we have recognized as Indian people all across this land, as third world people all across this land. As Dr. Abernathy said in Wounded Knee the other day, until the red man is free, no one will have freedom. And we recognize this also as a priority. And we are going to ask you to stand with us, to support it, to start telephone campaigns, telegram campaigns, to call on the United States government to show some decency for one time. So this is what we're going to be asking you to do. I only have now about 40 or 50 minutes, so I'll try to cover as much of the what the American Indian Movement stands for and what it's all about. I would first of all like to read to you something that was handed to me. You know, the issues at Wounded Knee are this. The issues are that the United States government honor its treaties. You know, on Election Day, I was in Washington, D.C. speaking with the peace coalitions at the anti-war rally. I heard Nixon state that the United States government always honors its treaties, making reference, of course, to the war in Vietnam. Now, as I've said before, and I'll say it again, that the President of the United States is either totally confused about domestic affairs and those issues affecting Indian tribes, or he's completely scholastically retarded in the area of Indian affairs. Because we recognize that we have 371 congressionally ratified binding contractual agreements that state very clearly, in addition to other considerations, that the United States government, in consideration of taking our lands, has agreed to provide health, has agreed to provide education assistance, has agreed to protect our lands, our resources, our minerals, and our way of life. And yet, after close to 80 years of their administration of our affairs through the Bureau of Indian Affairs, our lands have been diminished from 130 million acres to under 50 million acres of land in control of Indian tribes. So we are therefore stating very clearly that the United States government has totally violated those agreements, and at the present time, we've certainly exhausted our diplomatic efforts. We have tried to get along with this society and this government for 481 years. And like this country has done in the past, and they've certainly set the precedent, that at Wounded Knee, the new Ogallala Nation, 40 acres of ground, is going to continue to be a sovereign nation in this country, and it's going to be a start of an Indian revolution that's going to start restoring some decency and some morality to this country. And the red man is going to stand and show that kind of direction from this day forward. A reporter the other day said to me, it's kind of thought that 1973 would be the year of the Indian. And I told him very clearly that from now on, it's going to be the year of the Indian in this country. And from now on, Indian people are going to stand up. From now on, we are not going to tolerate the injustices of the courts in this land. Now, these are the issues. We asked for William Fulbright's Foreign Relations Committee to recognize Indian tribes as sovereignties, and to negotiate those treaties once again with us on the basis that we were sovereign nations when we entered into the treaties, and we are in fact still sovereign nations. We are asking that congressional Senate investigation take place immediately into the corruptive practices of the United States government, the Department of the Interior, and the Bureau of Indian Affairs. We are asking that those congressmen and senators who are not involved in the theft to start trying to do something about it. These are the issues, and we are going to continue fighting for those issues. Now, in addition to that, a plan was offered. They said, what are you going to do if you people do take your country back? What's going to be your policy? What's going to be your immediate plans? And I would like to read to you one position paper that was handed to us for our appraisal. And this particular proposal is called the White Policy Proposal. These are one of the plans that's being offered once we take over again. This is called the White Policy Proposal. It is hereby suggested that we create a Department of White Affairs for a trial period of 100 years. This department will be run strictly by Indians selected on the basis of their political affiliations and their incompetence in the business world. White people will be looked on as white savages unless they adopt the Indian religion and the Indian way of life. White religious holidays such as Easter and Christmas will be outlawed, and all religious statues, medals, and musical instruments shall be confiscated by a newly created Indian-mounted police force. It will be unlawful to wear shamrock, eat haggis, fish and chips, pea soup, wieners, and sauerkraut. We see those to be anti-Indian foods, and we can't allow you to continue those customs. If a white wants to sell, lease, or bequeath property, the Department of White Affairs will make the final decision. At no time will white people be able to develop his land without the consent of the Department of White Affairs. From time to time, advisors will be brought in from the Congo, Indonesia, and India to fill top civil service jobs and teach the whites religion and culture. It is quite conceivable that white lands will be expropriated for Indian interest in conserving the environment. It is recommended that a series of treaties be undertaken immediately with the white nations for the ceding of their interest in crown lands. They may keep the cities, because we recognize we're not quite ready to deal with that. They can have the cities. So this is one of the proposals that's been offered, and you must recognize that this is exactly what has happened to Indian people in our own land, that this is the kind of bureaucracy that still tries to control our lives, and they have clearly failed us. And I would like to state that the conditions in which Indian people are forced to live across this land, not only in the rural areas, not only in the reservations, but in the urban areas, is an indictment against the United States government. It's an indictment against the Department of the Interior, the Bureau of Indian Affairs, and finally, the society in America who have allowed this to continue. We recognize that the confrontation at Wounded Knee, the confrontation is not only with this bureaucratic agencies, but it's also with the conscience of America. Now, it's quite apparent here at UCLA that not many people are very much concerned with the conditions facing Indian people. Otherwise, I'm sure this hall would be filled. But we are happy that those of you who came here are apparently interested and curious enough to be concerned about what is happening at Wounded Knee. And so we recognize today, you know, we are not going to try to stereotype our white brothers the way they've stereotyped us. Even though the other day one of my brothers said, you know, he says it's really difficult. He said, we have a lot of people who want to offer their help to us today. He says, but it's really difficult to tell the good guys from the bad guys. He says, because they all look alike too. He says, they all got low cheekbones. So we recognize that, but we are not going to stereotype, because for today we see a generation of people. We see a generation of all colors of mankind who are now standing up and saying, yes, we want freedom, we want peace, we want a way of life that's going to serve all mankind. And on that level we can support one another. So I'm going to ask you once again to be at that demonstration today. I would like to go back and tell you a little bit about the American Indian Movement, and kind of bring you up to date from the Bureau of Indian Affairs occupation in Washington, D.C., to Custer, South Dakota, to our campaign through South Dakota in general, and finally the Wounded Knee occupation. I would like to first of all tell you something of the movement. Of course, in the papers today, we are described as the militant American Indian Movement. When we see these type of efforts by the press to discredit us, by tagging labels on us, it's the same type of discrediting efforts that took place against the Black Panthers in this country. It's the same type of discrediting effort that took place 150 years ago when they were out slaughtering Indian tribes from the face of the earth. That first of all, in order to commit genocide, one first of all has to discredit those people. They have to dehumanize those people. I would suspect that the attitude that was indicated in the New York Post, the headline said, first of all, Arabs slay envoys. Secondly, the next headlines was Nixon condemns terrorist tactics. And the third headlines was Indians on a warpath at Wounded Knee. Now, we haven't come very far in 100 years, because that was the same kinds of headlines we had when the Battle of the Bighorn was fought and Indian people formed together in a coalition and knocked the hell out of some cavalry. And we might see that repeated again today at Wounded Knee if they try to take us out of there, because we have committed ourselves to fight and die for that 40 acres of land which has become the new separate sovereign nation. And that land is going to grow and grow across this land until all Indian people stand up free and cut that paternalistic umbilical cord from the United States government, who is continually controlling our way of life. So the American Indian Movement then was formed in 1968 because we recognized that the conditions have deteriorated, that in spite of all the efforts made by churches to missionize us and come in and civilize us, so to speak, that they have totally failed us. that the United States government has totally failed themselves in their trust responsibility toward us. So the American Indian Movement was formed in 1968 by Indian people who were tired, by Indian people who are ready to stand up and fight for what we believed in. And because of that, this organization formed. And we were involved in many areas. We have many other programs that are affecting our communities. I would first of all like to give you this thing that was handed to me some months back, and it kind of sums up exactly what our organization stands for. It says, things won't ever quite be the same again, and that's what the American Indian Movement is all about. They are respected by many and hated by some, but they are never ignored. They are the shock troops of Indian sovereignty. They intend to raise questions in the minds of all, questions which have gone to sleep in the minds of Indians and non-Indians alike. From the outside, AIM people are tough people. They had to be. AIM was born out of the dark violence of police brutality and the voiceless despair of injustice in the courts of Minneapolis. AIM was born because a few knew that it was enough, enough to endure for themselves and all others like them who were people without power or rights. AIM people have known the insides of jails, the long wait, the no appeal of the courts for Indians because many of them were there. The AIM idea spread rapidly into the Great Lakes cities because other Indians knew the power of local Indian police watchmen, of local legal aid, of a place to stay where you could hold up your head and joke. And from the inside, AIM people are cleansing themselves. Many have returned to the old religions of their tribes, away from the confused notions of a society which have made us slaves of our unguided lives. AIM is first a spiritual movement, a religious rebirth, and then a rebirth of Indian dignity. AIM succeeds because it has beliefs to act on. AIM is attempting to connect the realities of the past with the promise of tomorrow. There are people in a hurry because they know that the dignity of a person can be finally broken or snuffed by despair and a belt in a cell of a city jail. They know the deepest hopes of the old people could die with them. They know that the Indian way is not tolerated in America because it is not acknowledged as a decent way to be. Sovereignty, land, and culture cannot endure if a people is not left in peace. AIM is then a new warrior class of this century, bound by the bond of the drum, who vote with their bodies instead of their mouths. Their business is hope. Incidentally, the man that wrote this paper is a man called Killstraight, and he is one of the Ogallala people who, in fact, has been making efforts to change the situation in South Dakota, and is, in fact, at this time at Wounded Knee. And these are the kind of people that we have in this organization. I'm going to go back a little bit to that meeting in 1968 when the organization formed. And at that time, they recognized that they had to be an organization that would stand as strong advocates for Indian people all across this land. Because we recognize that the conditions of a 42-year life expectancy, the conditions of inadequate health, inadequate education, and all these other conditions were the same and affecting us all the same. So the organization was formed to change these things. And at that time, we tried to identify what the three major enemies of Indian people were. And we recognized at that time that the concept of Christianity that came over here and tried to tell our people that our ways were uncivilized, that we had to give up our superstitions, that we had to change our pagan habits of worship, and that we had to become more civilized like the white man. So we recognized that Christianity, or the concept of Christianity, was our number one enemy. And this even comes as a shock for a lot of our Indian people who have embraced that faith. Because we recognize and we have respect for those people. And we recognize that perhaps they are the only people who really practice that way of life, because they, in fact, practiced it for thousands of years before the coming of the white man and the coming of the Bible and the coming of the white man's religion. So we say to those people that we have respect for them. But at the same time, we know today that the movement has gotten strong because our young people are once again embracing our elders, our spiritual leaders, our medicine men. And we are once again going back to the traditional way. And in doing so, we're introducing a new pride, a new integrity. And it's coming through re-identifying with our own ways. So the American Indian Movement, even though it's been described as the militant, radical, violent organization, people have to recognize that, like the ghost dance societies at Wounded Knee, we are once again back to spirituality also. So we know that this is the way that is going to that saved our people. And we know it was that power and those beliefs that have allowed us to endure 482 years of total suppression in this land. And we know it's the same kind of power that's going to make us successful at Wounded Knee. Because at Wounded Knee, before we make decisions affecting our people, we pray together. We sit down on the ground with the sacred pipe and we pray together to make those decisions. Like one of the medicine men said, I wonder if Nixon prays before he makes his decisions affecting his people. We think not. And we recognize that even though they have tried to discredit our ways, they tried to say we must forget our superstitions, we can only look at that same type of people who got off those boats with a Bible in one hand and a rifle in the other one and set out to conquer a whole nation of people. And we can only recognize long before they built their temples of God on every corner of America, on every corner of the world, where they capture God in the confines of four walls for their soul enjoyment on Sunday morning. That word spread across our homelands, that great hordes of missionaries in their white robes of purity were seen crossing our lands, practicing ritualistic orgies upon our people, forcing them underwater, submerged until they gasp for breath. This to indicate the fleeing of the evil spirits, and provided you live within the confines of that pageantry, you were saved. You know, you could either enter the great and glorious kingdom of heaven if you were good, or into hell if you were bad, contrary to the Indian way that we sat on the sacred Mother Earth and we prayed with the sacred herbs and the barks of trees and the sacred tobaccos. Our whole world was our temple. The whole world was our church. Yet those same people who come at us with their multi-million dollar temples, their thousand voice choirs singing the praises of something that don't even exist. There's an angelic haze comes over their face when they walk into those temples on Sunday morning. All of a sudden there's a holiness about them. When they walk out of church, that's all over with. Because the poverty and the conditions that face poor people, not only Indian people in this country, are still there. And all we are saying today is that we are going to complete We are going to, as Indian people, complete the mission for the churches in this country. We are going to take those same dollars that they have collected every year for Indian missions. We are going to take those dollars and start restructuring a new Indian America. And surprisingly enough, the churches have recognized that what you're saying is to be the truth. And they are funding us today. This is where we get our funds for our youth programs. This is where we get our funds to create alcoholic programs. This is where we get our funds to create alternative education programs in our communities. And I'll talk about that also. The American Indian Movement recognizes that we must go back to that traditional way. And in doing so today, we have a whole new society of warriors who are ready to stand and fight for what we believe to be the truth. And we are going to win. The bureaucracy, of course, as I talk, will be identified as one of our three top enemies. But education, today we have to review. We have to recognize that today we still have racist books in the libraries, in elementary schools, that still portray us as renegade savages who did nothing but go about beating the heads in on white people with a tomahawk, or discrediting terms like red devils, and things like Columbus discovered America. Now, isn't that something? The first white man that come in this direction was thousands of miles off course. He was lost, and a lot of them have been lost ever since. You know, we became Indians all of a sudden, you know. Overnight, the sovereign people here, the people, the original landholders in this part of the universe, all of a sudden became Indians. And yes, we use the term Indians to identify, because we recognize the whole system, you know, in this country. You know, the whole system that still, you know, gets their kids to play cowboys and Indians, you know, goes out and buy them a gun the first time they start walking. All of a sudden, they're playing cowboys and Indians, and the cowboys always win. Then they grow up, and they start going to school, and they read the same kind of literature. And our children are suffering from this, too. They go in, and they read things where George Washington is the father of your country. Now, hell, you know, you can tell your kids those fallacies, and you can continue to get that poison in their heads if you want. But we are saying today, we don't want you telling our children that. And consequently, we view education the same way our leaders viewed education way back in 1774. This is something that was spoken in 1774. It said, the commissioners from Maryland, Virginia, in negotiating treaties with the Indians of the Six Nations at Lancaster, Pennsylvania. The Indians were invited to send boys to William and Mary College. The next day, they declined the offer as follows. We know that you highly esteem the kind of learning taught in those colleges, and that the maintenance of our young men while with you would be very expensive to you. We are convinced that you mean to do us good by your proposal, and we thank you heartily. But you who are wise must know that different nations have different conceptions of things, and you will therefore not take it amiss if our ideas of this kind of education happen not to be the same as yours. We have had some experience of it. Several of our young men were formerly brought up at the colleges of the northern provinces. They were instructed in all your sciences, but when they came back to us, they were bad runners, ignorant of every means of living in the woods. Either fit for hunters, warriors, nor counselors, they were totally good for nothing. We are, however, not the less obliged by your kind offer, though we decline accepting it, and to show our grateful sense of it, if the gentlemen of Virginia will send us a dozen of their sons, we will take care of their education, instruct them in all we know, and make men of them. We know today that the education system in this country that I previously described, that continues to try to teach our young people things that aren't even relevant to what we want to know to begin with, or what we need for it. So when I was in school, incidentally, I feel kind of honored talking in this temple of higher learning here. When I was in eighth grade, somebody told me I had to know something about algebra and pi and all that stuff. I said, for what? You know, what's it going to do for me back on the reservation? You know, what's that going to do? So I dropped out. I'm kind of glad of it because I don't feel I need too much more of that kind of education. But I am an eighth grade dropout, and I recognize today, as we have come to recognize, that the education system of this land that's been directed toward and just an extension of European culture has taken many, many of our young men and women and has, in fact, encouraged them to come into the system and to assimilate it into white America. And for many years, all these young people were doing exactly that. But over the past few years, when there's a new awareness brought about, when the issues and the problems started to be surfaced, there's a whole new feeling today. And we know that in these colleges and universities that these kinds of programs set up for Indian education and for education of other minorities, the monies must be doubled or tripled. Because we know also that we must have hundreds of young Indian men and women going to colleges to learn more of your ways. But in elementary school and high school, what's most important is that they start learning who they are, that they start learning their languages so that they could come back and be good counselors for our youth, that they start learning our religion, that they start learning true history and teach that true history to not only our children but to our little white counterparts, our black brothers, and all other races of mankind. Because we recognize that until Indian people start re-identifying and start taking on this new pride, that they will continue to assimilate into the melting pot or into the mainstream, which has totally failed, incidentally. Now, the old melting pot concept, you know, for 400 and some years, some Indian people have tried to assimilate into that mainstream, and we have been kicked off. We've tried to get into the melting pot, and we settled to the bottom. So what we're saying today, when we talk about sovereignty at Wounded Knee, we mean that we be allowed to determine our own future, which to us is total self-government. So in the area of education, we dealt with that. We have what we call the survival schools. We have three of them functioning at the present time, one in St. Paul, one in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and one in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And they have from 80 to 100 students and are directed toward elementary levels, where these young people are coming in contact with the juvenile courts. And as a last resort, they have turned these young people back to us. And we can see now that we are on the right track, because these young people who have been pushed out of the education system are now functioning and are happy and they're really starting to learn something that's relevant to what they want to know. So we want that to become a prototype and establish these schools throughout the reservation areas. So we are dealing with the solutions as we see them. And we are supporting those programs on colleges that have education programs, Indian cultural awareness, etc., because we see this as a very meaningful effort. The American Indian Movement has formed in many communities legal services complexes. We have formed housing, job development, emergency food assistance in the urban areas. Because we recognize that the government's policy of relocation that took place all these years, and it's important that I explain this to you, because all these years they have been trying to assimilate us into the urban areas. They had a program called the Relocation Program, and it's been successful in some sense. But we find that most of those programs planned by the government are planned to fail. They're planned to do one thing, to bring people into the urban areas, and once they get them there, to drop them. And the problems in the urban areas are compounded by that. And we see of the estimated 850,000 Indian people today, there's approximately 300,000 in the urban areas. And it was from these people who was able to go out and see both sides of the coin, to recognize the theft that was going on against our homelands, is where the American Indian Movement started. But because of its immediate success, it immediately spread into the reservation areas. It spread into the other urban areas across the country. We have probably about 75 chapters at this point. Last week in Oklahoma, we formed 6 more organizations. So the movement is growing. Now, in regards to we first became real visual in this country, and they've always said to us, you know, how come you just start demonstrating recently? How come you haven't demonstrated before this? We have said to you that we have been demonstrating for 482 years. We have demonstrated against this system by a 60 to 90% dropout rate or pushout rate in the schools. We have demonstrated against this system because of the high alcoholic rate that affects our people today, and it's one of the poisons that we are striking at and trying to get our brothers on their feet with clear heads so they can fight the real war. We have demonstrated at the Battle of the Bighorn. We demonstrated at Sand Creek, Colorado. We demonstrated at Washita Creek in Oklahoma. We've demonstrated all across this country, and they just haven't taken the time to look and see what we are doing. And we believe now that the fact that the so-called longest undeclared war in history, the war that just came to a close in Southeast Asia, supposedly, was not the longest undeclared war. And now that things are over with over there, when they can start focusing on domestic affairs, just when they thought the war was over, they got a war with the Indian people here again. And this is why they're finding it difficult to deal with it. We went to Washington, D.C. back in November. We went there all across this country, envoys from the Indian nations went there to draw national and international attention to those conditions affecting our people. We went there in peace. We said very clearly when we left San Francisco, Los Angeles, and Seattle, we said that we were going to Washington as a spiritual movement. We were going there as a religious movement and an educational seminar to show our people how the bureaucracy controls our lives. We said that we were going there not to burn, not to destroy property, not to overturn flags, not to shout obscenities in the streets, because that's not our language anyhow. That we were going there to stand once again as red men and say to this country, according to the Constitution, we have a right to petition Congress for change. We went there to do that. And I guess with the cowboy and Indian image that's portrayed all these years, where as little children they play cowboys and Indians, then they watch the movies, they watch TV, they read the books, I guess they figured we were all coming there, you know, on a warpath, you know, to start beating the heads in on white bureaucrats with clubs. And once we got there, we wished and thought maybe that's what we'd have to do. Because we were immediately met with hostility. We were immediately met with a police department in Washington, D.C. who were fully armed for a riot. We were immediately met with park police on horseback who had clubs 3 feet long. Washington, D.C., the GSA security guards were immobilized with gas masks. We couldn't believe it. We said, where's the reception here for Indian people? Where's that reception that you extend from dignitaries from foreign countries who are supposed to be enemies of this country? Well, they roll out the red carpet. We went there in peace, and we were met with violence. And on the day that it was finally decided that we would be allowed to stay in the Bureau of Indian Affairs building. And I should explain that too. As I said before, in the treaties, the government took a trust responsibility to take care of their red children. So we went there only to ask them to honor that consideration and to provide housing for the several hundred Indian people who were coming into Washington. And yet we were met with violence. We went there with a paper called the Renewal of Contracts, Reconstruction of Indian Communities, and Securing an Indian Future in America. And a lot of work went into this. It's 20 solutions for problems that we see facing our people. It talks about sovereignty. It talks about protecting our land, our resources, our minerals. It talks about pollution. You know, we recognize that Indian people were the first ecologists here, who lived within a balance of nature, with respect for all living things. And we kept this land pretty clean and unpolluted before the coming of civilization. So this paper was put to work, a lot of work went into it. Hours of work went into it. We knew that if the government would apply itself to this, that we could change things. We went there to introduce bills, legislation, and yet we were met with violence. We were in fact assaulted on the first day, and at that time we occupied that building. In the efforts to barricade windows and doors, copy machines were moved about, and I would say probably on the first confrontation there was maybe $10,000 worth of equipment destroyed. Over the coming weeks, they continued to set moratoriums. They said, you're going to get out of this building by 6 o'clock or we're going to come in and get you. And we dug in. We said, come on and get us. And on one evening out there, when they were going to give us a final deadline, like they did at Wounded Knee, we called their bluff and they said, you can come in and negotiate or you can come in fighting. And they never came in. But that building was systematically destroyed. And it became an emblem, a memorial for the new Indian resistance in this country. And we did not want to destroy that building. Not one of us went there to occupy that building. And yet the unconcerned, insensitive bureaucracy forced this whole thing. And finally they paid us $66,500 to leave town, and there hasn't been any arrest to date. So I guess that's a pretty good lesson that what we went there for was right, and they recognize now their crimes against us. But the whole destruction became a key issue nationwide. Automatically, the United States government contacted various tribal councilmen that they knew throughout the country that had already sold out to the government and solicited condemnations. And the whole issue then became the destruction, and I would like to read you a couple of things here that was written by our people in answer to that destruction. This was put on a wall of the Bureau of Indian Affairs, and it says, gentlemen, we do not apologize for the ruin nor the so-called destruction of this mausoleum. For in building anew, one must first destroy the old. This is the beginning of a new era for Native American people. When history recalls our efforts here, our descendants will stand with pride, knowing their people were the ones responsible for the stand taken against tyranny, injustice, and the gross inefficiencies of this branch of corrupt and decadent government. When I got back to Denver, Colorado, a man wrote me another note, and he said, I want you to use this. He said, because even though we weren't in Washington, we know that the overwhelming majority of Indian people in this country, and liberal whites, blacks, and other organizations, support you totally. He said, I want you to use this paper, he says, and use it any way that you want. And I think it pretty much sums up the position of the American Indian movement and a lot of Indian people in this country today. It says, it is with a feeling of sorrow that we must address ourselves to the American people, to the President of the United States, and to the spokesmen for the tribal chairmen who have failed to see the true significance of the Trail of Broken Treaties. The issue is not, was not, nor ever will be the occupation of the Bureau of Indian Affairs and the destruction of a certain amount of property by a group of angry Indian people. The issue is, was, and forever will be the occupation of Indian land and the near destruction of a people by a nation of greedy and deceitful white men. To the American people, I say, do not be outraged at the administration for allowing the Indians to occupy the Bureau quarters for 7 days. Is this not your administration? Is not political expediency the ultimate operative motive which you have endorsed by re-electing Mr. Nixon? Do not be outraged that in a negotiation a promise was made to the Indians that there would be no prosecution. Is it not politically expedient for Mr. Lesh to lie to the Indians to avoid a confrontation and then prosecute to placate your outrage? Red Cloud said, they made us many promises more than I can remember. They never kept but one. They promised to take our land, and they took it. But if you do have any values higher than that of possession of land, money, and prestige, I would ask you to be outraged that your government values property more than human beings. Be outraged that your government officials tell lies. Be outraged that Indian teenagers are committing suicide because their world appears hopeless. Be outraged that government agencies spend money not for the educational needs of Indian children, but rather for the career needs of non-Indian government employees. Be outraged that your government is destroying a people in Vietnam, just as they are destroying the Indians. Sand Creek, Wounded Knee, Hanoi, My Lai. This is your government. These are your leaders. If you ask me, do you endorse the wanton destruction of property, I ask you, do you endorse theft of property, either outright or through deception and lies? No, I do not endorse destruction of property, but I say to you, if to destroy a small amount of your possessions is the only way to make you listen, then maybe it is time we made you listen. To the tribal chairmen, we say, do not discard the participants of the Trail of Broken Treaties as non-Indians. The anger that burns in their hearts is the anger that burns in the hearts of your sons and your daughters, your mothers and your fathers. And it should be an anger which burns in your own hearts. If you looked with a cleansed vision, not the vision of a politician, but rather the vision of a true leader of your people, you will see that your sons and your daughters were there. You will see that for every broken window in the bureau quarters, there are thousands of broken hearts among your people which cannot be repaired. Aren't your people worth more than the taxpayers' money? Indeed, isn't the taxpayers' money the money that came from the rape of your lands? Be angry, but not at the destruction of the interior furnishings of the bureau. Be angry at the deceit of the United States government, and more than being morally outraged at the deceit, be angry at the deeds of the United States government and the deeds of the white man as he tries to destroy the Indian to gain possession of our land. Be angry about the broken treaties of yesterday, the broken promises of today, and the dim prospects of tomorrow. Condemn the immorality of the white man in his dealings with you, not the actions of your sons and your daughters, your mothers and your fathers. Actions incurred only to get someone to listen to Indian grievances. The issue is, are you satisfied with our present subservient status? What does sovereignty mean if you have no control over your own affairs? What is sovereignty if you let Mr. Nixon, Mr. Lesh, and Mr. Rogers dictate to you? To the President of the United States, we submit the following. You have begun a historic and new relationship with Indian people by advocating self-determination. People believed you. Do not withdraw your commitment. Do not leave another trail of broken promises to mark your place alongside those from George Washington to Eisenhower, whose policies were aimed at our destruction as a people. Perhaps we should address you in the terms which it appears you understand and to which you respond. Deal with us by responding to our grievances, or we shall continue to deal with you by forcing you to listen to our grievances. That pretty much sums up the feelings of the American Indian movement. As we recognize today that even though there is a new awareness taking place against by all people, we understand that all these years that all people have been sympathetic to our, toward our cause. In fact, all these years, in addition to the 850,000 Indian people that live here on this land, that we have 2-3 million other people who have identified with their Indian heritage some way. Some of them, in fact, being Indians, but a lot of them just wanting to identify with something that's real. And because of that, we have a phenomena today in this country. Because apparently back 100 years ago, or 200 years ago, we had bands of Indians that had absolutely no men. I would like to refer to the identity crisis that faces a lot of our white brothers today that claim to be a 64th Cherokee or 132nd Cherokee. And in that itself is a lesson, because we recognize that it always has to be Cherokee, Choctaw, Creek, or one of the five civilized tribes. Because it's more fashionable, if you're going to be Indian, to be an Indian, at least that's civilized versus the uncivilized. We also recognize that it's really ironic. You know, like I said before, we must have had a whole nation of Cherokee people who had no men. Because for some strange reason, it was always their grandmother who was Indian. And it had to be royalty. It just couldn't be just a common Indian. It had to be Indian princess. You know, she was a daughter of a chief. I guess in that, they could identify with the fact that the Cherokees, you know, they had their own alphabet, and they cauterized their own laws. They even got plantations, ranches, farms. They run businesses. They even outdid their white brothers in the business world. And yet that did not save the Cherokee people, because they were systematically annihilated and removed from their lands too. So I say to all my brothers and sisters who are thinking very strongly of buying that bill of goods about a simulation and going into that great and glorious society that we are still the sovereign people that this government has to deal with and take a lesson for what happened to the Cherokee. You know, I guess they always thought, you know, it was perfectly all right, you know, for this great plainsman, you know, this European, you know, frontierman coming across our lands, and all of a sudden he found an Indian encampment there, and there was a little Indian princess out there, you know, looking in a pool. You've seen the movie, you know, she's looking in a pool of water or something, and a big white man comes by and wins her heart, you know, and from this union, of course, comes a whole civilization of Cherokees and Choctaws. And I say there are real Cherokees. I run into some full-blooded Cherokees, some half-breeds, some quarter-breeds. I run into some brothers who have so little Indian blood in them that they look white. But in their heart here, in their mind, they're standing and fighting with us at Wounded Knee today. And those are real Indians. This identity thing that sets in, you know. I guess none of them ever thought, I'm waiting for some one of them to come up to me and say, I'm Cherokee. It was my great-great-grandfather. You know, because maybe it might have been this way, you know. Maybe there was a wagon train going across our land, and they were encamped there near an Indian encampment, and a war party came by, a scouting party, and you've seen the movies, you know, and they're sitting in camp that night, and the wagon train's all in a circle, and fires, and they're playing a guitar and singing some of those old songs, you know, real sing-along, you know. All of a sudden, a little blonde-haired, blue-eyed girl, she kind of strays out of the camp, and she hears some of those sounds out there, woo-hoo, you know, you've seen the movies. You've seen them all. You know, she strays a little further, and finally she maybe runs into this common Indian, you know. He's a warrior, right? Maybe he kind of sells out a little bit and has a very good, you know, thing there for about 4 hours. And maybe that's the way it started, you know. I'm just waiting for somebody to come tell me that their great-grandfather was a Cherokee Indian, and he was a full-blood, you know. I mean, you see, even in that, you know, the racism comes to the surface, you know. They want to identify with us. They're sympathetic. We're saying for those people who are sympathetic to now stand with Indian people. We went to Custer, South Dakota, because we found injustice. We found a case where a man was murdered, and his murderer, who was white, was charged with second-degree manslaughter, released on a $5,000 bond. In the next county, a young Indian man was arrested because he happened to be in a proximity where a white woman was murdered. On the basis of testimony by another drunken guy who told somebody else, this man was arrested, charged with first-degree murder, and held without bond. Contrary to the Constitution of the United States. And we see these things throughout this land. At Custer, South Dakota, we told them there that no more. At Wounded Knee, we're saying no more. And for the next months, we're going to form coalitions with the Vietnam Veterans Against the War. Fact is, we're going to start a whole recruiting program again. We're going to take all those people in this country who want peace, who want to stop pollution in this land, who want to stop Black Mesa, the strip mining of our lands, who want to stop the pollution of our valleys and our atmosphere, and who are really sincere in doing that, to form together in the strongest coalition to date, and Indian people will stand and give you direction and help you in bringing about peace in this land. And for the next months and the next years, we're going to go to Washington. We're going to petition Congress the same way that we have a right to in the Declaration of Independence. And we're going to read that Declaration of Independence to you over these coming years. We're going to let you know what it says. And it says very clearly, when that form of government suppresses the people, when that form of government no longer